friends, and this is Ella, and we're going to demonstrate a novice twirl section with some simple movement blended in. Ready? Okay. We're going to start with our feet together. Ready, set, go. Swing, swing, point your right toe out, and we're going to keep our heel tucked under in the window. Over the left arm, rainbow, close your feet, shoulder pass, bicycle, sit to the heels. I'll let her demonstrate that. Can opener point, and we're going to arabesque on the can opener. Did you do the arabesque? Let's try that again. Can opener with the arabesque, and then point to the front, back scratcher, scratch your hand loose, and spin to the front. There you go. Okay, some of the things that we're focusing on, blending the body face to side, is when she does the bicycle, the simple bend of the knee, go ahead, bicycle, how she sits all the way down and focusing on keeping her knees together, come back up. And then let's do the can opener. Good. Put your feet back together. And when you teach it, you want to step onto that right foot with the knee tight on her toe. And we learned how to step into the PK. Good. And then blending the baton and body is pretty hard right there. It's a pretty hard skill for a novice. Try it again. Good. Now start with your feet together. Step onto the right foot and flip the baton at the same time. There we go. And then step back down and point to the front. So the main thing is that we want to keep the body simple if we're putting demand on the baton, and then vice versa. We want to keep the baton simple if we're putting demand on the body. Especially for 6 to 8 year olds, they're going to have a hard time with the mental demand of the whole routine to begin with. So one thing or the other. I like to make sure that I do everything in 8-count intervals if possible. And I always try to teach everything on the right hand that I do on the left hand. And then the same thing with the feet, everything on the right foot that I do with the left foot. So that when they get older, we have a broad scope of movement, broad scope of baton skills that we can develop and use on either side. It makes their training a lot easier as they get older to do it that way.
When showing them or telling them doesn't work, don't be afraid to reach down there and twist that foot or pick that foot up and put it where you need it to be. Because sometimes the others don't work and you just have to give them that physical feeling of where their foot needs to go or where their baton needs to go. Help them to feel the muscle memory or learn that muscle memory by showing them where it needs to be. I know that the desire is always to try and do things that we find innovative or something that no one has ever done before, but sometimes it's good to go back and look at what other people have done and use those skills. We don't have to reinvent the wheel every time we put a routine together or every time we try to teach a new set of students. Sometimes it's good to reuse routines that you've already done or skills that you've already taught. You know how to do it, it's safe, it's worked before, so why not use it again? That doesn't mean you do the same thing every single time. But the solo that I've used as a demonstration is the same solo that I did when I was a little girl, that my daughter did when she was a little girl, and all of my students have done because it's been time-tested. Now, yes, we've changed it over the years, and yes, we've added movement to it, which is wonderful for this project, where we're blending the baton with the body. And we've just learned over the years that we need to add more to it, how to make the baton move smoother from place to place. And so we've changed those things over the years to make it a better program.
I enjoy teaching children to use mnemonic patterns, having them say the words to the routine, maybe say the footsteps or say what the baton is going to be doing, or sing along with the music instead of saying the words to the music, say what the feet are going to be doing to help them memorize the routine. They can even say it as they're performing the routine to help with the memorization or help with the unison of the routine. It's a very useful tool whenever they're learning something new or even when they're performing something new.
I always ask myself what my purpose is. Who am I trying to entertain? Is this going to be for the parents that I'm putting this together? Is it a show at the end of the year? Is it a recital? Is this just a Christmas performance that we're doing for school? Is this something fun that we're doing for the kids in the program? So if I can keep
my end goal in mind, then I know what I'm leading toward, and I can make my choices for what really needs to go in the routine based off of that. And then set the little goals to match the big goal at the end.
As a new coach and with new students, I think that if you will invest your time looking at the details, especially on beginning poses, how to turn their foot to make sure their heel is turned under, if their foot is out in second position, to get the heel under in that window, the foot placement there, or if it's turned to the back where their heel should be turned, how to point the toe. Those details right from the start, looking there, would really make a big difference for these younger athletes. Spend the time on the details, and that's going to help you out quite a bit.
It doesn't have to be the legs that we focus on either. It can be the arms, a simple arm circle, or a turn of the head, snap the head to the front if you're doing a dance twirl, a head circle, something simple like that. If you focus on different areas of the body, that might be helpful too. A shoulder isolation or some movement like that could be pretty simplistic that the kids this age can do. If it looks wrong, there's a reason why, and we need to figure out why it looks wrong. So you probably don't want to use that particular movement blended with that particular skill in the routine. Save it for later. Figure out what you're doing wrong and then go back and try it again.
Things like tendu, just pointing your toe in a certain position, making sure the heel is turned under, the bend, keeping the knees together, kneeling down correctly, a spin step, using an arabesque, things like that. It doesn't have to be a kick or a cartwheel or some major body move at this level in particular. So any sort of movement that you can add to make the baton more interesting is going to be helpful, especially for this age group.
Every choice that's being made from the design standpoint is based on the music. We let the music design the program for us, or at least drive the choices that we're making. If you are choreographing to a piece of music that has words and the music says jump, are you going to use the body to jump at that point? What are you going to do to be creative with the baton while you jump? Where are you going to place it? Those are the things you need to plan out before you actually teach the routine to the kids. Creativity is a key part of being able to blend the baton and body. The baton can be useful in the movement without actually twirling also. You can use it in a pose, like holding both ends and putting it on your shoulder, or using both hands and putting it up above your head, holding the ends. And it's useful to the movement without actually having to spin or having to flip. So you can be creative with where you place the baton and focus on the dance, and it looks like it's staged really well without actually putting a lot of demand on the baton. So we try to use that as well, rather than holding the baton in cradle for every movement that you do.
Okay, kneel down. Foot, yucky, yucky, yucky. All right, stand back up. Now let's show everyone how we do our pretty kneel down. Lift our toe and waist.
One thing I really spend a lot of time on is teaching the proper way to kneel down. Kids don't naturally understand how to lift their foot and place it on the floor with the top of their foot first. They tend to bend the toes and kneel down, or maybe hit the floor really hard with their knee. So we practice that skill quite a bit to make sure that there's a pretty way to kneel down versus an ugly way to kneel down. And I think that helps them quite a bit, learning how to lift their foot and place the toes properly to kneel down.
Do the ugly one for me again, crinkly toes. Ready, go. Yucky, yucky, goodness, something like that. All right, stand up, try again. Now let's see if we can make it feel right. Do pretty toe. Lift and point. So much.
I got you. This is a completely recreational program. It is not intended to be competitive, but they did get to go and perform their routine at a competition. All of these twirlers are brand new. This is their first year to twirl. and they're all between the ages of 6 and 8 years old. We have a set basic twirls skill list that we use to develop their baton handling skills, and then we choose movements that we think are developmentally appropriate for their age group and for their body types that we blend with the baton. In this piece of music, the sleeve is part of the action, so the designer has written it so that they use the arm to show off the sleeve, and that's part of the intricacy of the movement and the design of the program. If you're lucky enough that there is a chorus in the piece of the music, use it. For sure, you can repeat. In a group routine, not every child has to be able to do every skill. So you try to keep in mind their body styles and what their limitations are going to be. Some kids aren't going to be able to do the cartwheel in the routine, so you don't have to feature those kids. You have them do something that is going to look good for them. So maybe you can put them on the corners and have them do their big flourish while the other kids do their cartwheel. Or you put them on their knees and have them do something pretty with their flat twirl while the other kids do whatever their featured dance movement is going to be. It doesn't have to be every child trying everything. So I just really have a hard time seeing it whenever teachers will put in a skill that's not mastered. They don't all have to try the cartwheel on the floor. So I only put things in, or try. I say I only do it, but of course you have to build some things into the routine that you're wanting the child to do eventually. But I try to use skills that are mastered and then leave the other things out that aren't going to make the program look good if you're going to competition. Now, if it's a recreational program and you're building the skills, sure. You just want to use whatever you're building for the next year or let everybody try it. But the biggest rule is just don't do something that's ever going to jeopardize the safety of the child. I really cringe when I see young coaches putting in illusions or things that you know their athletes aren't really ready for at an early age because they think that that's what the judges are looking for, or that's what the athlete needs to be successful in that category because other kids are doing it. I promise you, if those kids are doing those hard moves at that early age, it's because they're getting more than 45 minutes of lessons in a week. They're doing extra dance training, or they're doing extra gymnastics training. They're not getting it in their baton lesson, or they have some other sort of training going on. So please don't feel like you're supposed to be teaching all of your novice or beginner athletes those skills in 45 minutes one time a week and expect everyone on your team to be able to do those skills. If it's not mastered, again, I wouldn't put it in their routine. There is a logical progression of skills for the body, just like there is for the baton. So we don't skip steps. I guess my biggest piece of advice would be, if you don't know why something looks wrong or how to fix something, ask for help. There are so many videos out there. If you can't find it on YouTube, if you can't figure it out on your own, don't be afraid to ask for help. It doesn't make you less of a person or less of a coach. It doesn't mean you're going to lose your students. Just reach out and ask. There's always someone willing to help you. We all are continuing to grow in this sport. Even the masters have questions sometimes. So we need to reach out and depend on each other. I've been doing this for years, and I still have my go-to people that I'll call and say, look, this isn't working. I don't know how to fix it. Can you help me? And there's someone there that will answer the question for you. So please reach out. We're always here to help. Get home with your grace. Give them faith so she'll be saved. Lead her to our place. Get home with your grace. It's important to remind yourself that not everyone wants to be a world champion. Sometimes they just want to march in a parade, or sometimes they just want to do this to make their mom happy. So we just have to decide what's important for that day and push as hard as we can push for that day and make them happy. They have made on my life. Amen.
Really fun. Any questions? Well, I just wrote gobs of notes. I did especially like back scratcher and can opener. Those weren't part of my vocabulary just yet. So I really appreciate knowing that. Really a great presentation. Thanks, Lori, very much. And that was not a recreational team at the very last group on the floor, was it?
Not at all.
That was sort of the results of some years of training.
For sure.
Thanks very much. Well, Patty W., are you online? Anybody see Patty W.? Oh, good. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Glad to see you. I have such a hard time seeing people on this screen. They're right in front of me, but I don't succeed ever. Welcome, Patty.
Hi, good to be here.
I asked Patty if she'd be willing to do a spotlight interview with us this month, and she graciously agreed to do it. So we're just going to take a few minutes. I'll shoot a question or two out at her, and go ahead and elaborate, please, Patty. Patty's one of our mentors and is a coach and team director in New Jersey. Well, Patty, how long have you been coaching and in what setting? And what are your general goals as a baton coach?
Well, I've been coaching my entire life. I actually started when I was 12 years old in my parents' basement. I think the going rate was 50 cents an hour. And I just fell in love with it then, and I've never stopped. I've coached in a variety of settings. I do a lot of rec, everything from the YMCA to local rec programs. I really enjoy working with a high school marching band with the twirlers there. I've been there many, many years. And then I also have competitive teams. So basically I'm able to recruit via the rec programs, and then the kids that are more interested in focus can come onto the competition teams. So that's been a good feeder program for me.
And what are some of your accomplishments as a coach and professional member of USTA? Have you always been a part of USTA?
No, I actually twirled NBTA, and I went to my first USTA Nationals, I think 1997, and I fell in love, and I had a wonderful mentor in Karen Kamer. And I was very intimidated, I have to tell you, and I sympathize because I do have a lot of young coaches in New Jersey that were somewhat intimidated by USTA. So she mentored me, and I really feel proud that I've mentored a lot of other coaches in New Jersey to get them involved into USTA. And they very much now appreciate the amount of training. We just did a bunch of judges level one accomplishments. I think we have 5 or 6 judges in New Jersey now. So I think in terms of accomplishment, I like that ambassadorship. And talking about how wonderful USTA is and all of the things that can be accomplished with the support that you guys give. I'm also happy to be involved in the pre-trials program with teams and individuals. That's been a lot of fun. And my biggest pride, I think, in accomplishment is when my students go on to become coaches and judges or twirl in college. I really enjoy that. I have 2 young people coaching for me right now that came up through the system. And I have kids that have started other programs in other parts of the country. So I really love when I see that to go to the next generation.
Very cool. Well, tell us about your day job, Patty.
Well, I'm retired as of March 1st. Very exciting. I was with a school district for 42 years, Bergen County Special Services, which is a receiving district for students with disabilities. And I fulfilled all my career goals there. It was wonderful. The last 7 years, I was able to create a program, a shared time vocational program, to get students out to work and learn how to live in the community. And that was kind of the icing on the cake for all of the years that I spent at Special Services.
Thanks.
But I love retirement. <It's wonderful. laughs> I can just do baton all the time.
Tell us something about you that many other people don't know.
I collect baton memorabilia. So I have a lot of vintage things, old ads, you name it. I have it, quite a collection. So I enjoy that. It's a lot of fun.
And Patty, you're currently mentoring in the USTA mentoring program, are you not?
Correct. Yes. I'm very happy to have been invited, and it's been a wonderful experience. And again, I think that that is unique to this organization, that you give us the opportunity to do that and you open the communication. I think the communication is wonderful. So happy to be doing that.
Thanks a lot, Patty. Appreciate it. Stacy Forbus from Alabama has a great after school program, and she's going to talk with us about it right now. Welcome, Stacy.
Thank you for having me. Let me see if I can share my screen. Uh-oh. Michael might have to help me if I mess this up.
Oh, you're good.
Okay. All right. So my after school program started about 20 years ago, and I feel like the main thing about the after school program and why it is successful is because it is after school. And the parents don't have to bring their kids anywhere. They just dismiss and they go to the gym. And then the parents pick them up an hour later after school gets out. So if school gets out at 3, they don't have to pick them up till 4. So that's the reason why I feel like it is a very successful program. It allows, especially the stay-at-home moms, another hour, you know, before they have to get their child from school. I don't think I have this right, Michael. Oh, well, this will work. Okay, so the first thing I did when I decided I wanted to do this was find a school that had a gym that I could use, that had enough space for the kids. And I was pleasantly surprised. My first year, I had about 100 kids. This year, we're running about 130 kids in the program, which is great. And I have been able to mentor some of the kids that started with me a long time ago, that they are now coaching for me. And some of my college age kids actually have a school of their own, and they get paid 50% of the tuition of whatever comes in to that school. So when I wanted to start the program, I had to figure out what I was going to be offering, why a principal would say yes to a baton twirling program coming to their school. So from a standpoint of a principal, you know, they're trying to grow their students to become productive adults and citizens. So, you know, that we all know that baton twirling teaches leadership, time management, boys, focus, all these things that principals would want their students to have, all these different life skills that their students are going to need. So that kind of helped sell the program to the principal. And it wasn't just something that I want to do that was going to benefit me and my pocketbook, but it was also going to develop their students to become better students. The school also gets, from each one of my classes, they get 10% of the tuition. When I first started out 20 years ago, they didn't charge me anything, and it was great. So I didn't have to charge very much for my classes. I charged about $25 a month for 1 hour a week. And, you know, that was great. But then eventually they started charging for rent and stuff like that. So I've had to raise the tuition to help pay and offset the cost of the renting of the schools. But it hasn't changed the success of the program. Especially during COVID, I was surprised that we didn't get to start on time with the school year. Normally start in September when school starts. We didn't get to start this past year until November, but I have the highest number of participants this year that I've ever had, because I think the parents just wanted their kids involved in something. So this year we have about 130 kids, when in the past it's been about 100, maybe 120. So it's been really great this year. They did add a special cleaning fee on to COVID, but I just, because of COVID, and I just decided to absorb that because most of my classes are over at 4. And another side note to this is I use these classes, these school classes, as a feeder program into my competition teams, because I have competition twirlers and teams and things like that. And my older coaches, as they grow, you know, you coach the coach on how to coach, and they are coaching private lessons. So it's not all on me, but and it develops the coaches as well as the students. So when I use the school gym, the school board now charges me $15 an hour to use the gym. And then the school itself gets 10% of the tuition. And the principals love that because they can use it at their discretion, whatever they want to use it for. Some of them have end of the year teacher parties and they buy all the food with all the baton fees for their teachers. I think this is key. Building relationships, just like anything in life, build relationships with the people that you're working with. I try to fly under the radar, make it super easy for all my principals. Try not to cause any trouble. Don't ask anything of the office staff. I don't like my parents. Like if a student forgets their baton that day, I always make sure I have extra batons. So if they forget their baton, their parent doesn't have to bring it to the office and interrupt the office staff, you know, whatever they're doing to bring the baton to the gym and things like that. So I really try to make it really easy for everybody at the school and get to know everybody, especially the principals and the assistant principals. The best friends are the custodians at the schools. They are the ones that are in charge of the gym. They're the ones that are going to let you in, let you out, all that kind of stuff. A lot of the schools have just given me keys since I've been doing it for so long. I'm kind of grandfathered in now, but the custodians, they're awesome. And the PE teachers, they're the ones that are going to be in the gyms when you get there. So they're going to end up being the people that you really want to be friends with. And it kind of comes naturally because everybody is there to, you know, better the students and help them learn and just become better as they're growing. Sorry, my cat's down here. And the baton parents, you know, we all know that life will be easier without the parents sometimes, but we have to, you know, make the best of everything. And before I was teaching baton, I was in the corporate world. So, you know, the customer is always right. And, you know, you just do everything you can. And even to the point where if a student, like if a parent says, for example, they can't afford, they're going through some hardships, you know, we have hurricanes where I live in Alabama. And so I just create a scholarship program, which basically is just, I don't charge them. So it's not really a scholarship, but that's kind of what I tell them so that every student, every child can participate if they want to. I don't ever want to say, no, you can't participate because you can't afford it or you can't afford a costume or, you know, anything like that. I try to make sure that everybody has an opportunity to twirl because this is where my heart is. And constantly saying please and thank you, you know, just all the basic stuff. All that goes a long way. I try to seek out performances for the girls to perform so that their parents spend $80 on a costume. They get to wear it four times, maybe five times throughout the year. This past year, as we all know, has been tough. Our Christmas parade got canceled. We have two of them because I teach in Daphne and Fairhope. They're two adjoining towns. And our Christmas parade got canceled. So I was lucky enough to be able to just create one of our own. We used a school parking lot and started at one end and paraded through the parking lot and ended at the other end. And it was amazing. It was so much fun and everybody enjoyed it. We have festivals. We do a recital, city events. We have a huge arts and crafts festival in Fairhope. Every year it draws hundreds of thousands of people from all over the place. Of course, it was canceled this past year. But we always perform there, you know, one school at a time. And then my fire baton team will perform at that as well. And church festivals. So there's plenty of opportunities out there to perform. And when you're seeking these opportunities, these organizations, they want you to come because you bring more people to whatever they're doing. If they're trying to sell something at a festival or, you know, churches are trying to get more people to their church or, you know, things like that. So they're really open to the idea when we perform, we, you know, with 100 kids, you're going to bring 300 people with you. So they really like when we come to perform it, especially like at the Arts and Crafts Festival, they put us on right before they introduce the mayor and all the city dignities and stuff like dignitaries and people like that, so that there's a huge crowd there when everybody's meeting the mayor. So much fun living in a smallish town. The business side of it, it's not my favorite side, but it's stuff that has to happen. You know, get a business license. You're going to need it for when you get costumes, and you could get a discount on the costume, so you can sell your costumes for retail, but you buy them for half that cost. So those companies, the costume companies like Weissman and different places like that, are gonna need you to have a business license to give you a discount. Join USTA. I grew up MBTA, and I'm still fairly new to USTA. I think I've been with USTA for, I think it's been 5 years. And I love the way the program works, and the mentorship that I've gotten out of USTA has been really, really great. Insurance certificates, you can get those through USTA if you have a professional membership, easy to do. A business checking account, parents can pay Venmo, PayPal. Get a business account with Starline, because again, you can make 50% profit on the batons that you sell. And again, the costume companies. I have several different costume companies, but I seem to always go to Weissman because they're quick to deliver and easy to order for the school type costumes, you know. Getting the word out. I'm kind of old fashioned, you know, social media is great and all, but I like the good old paper flyers. I print them out, have them, you know, distributed through the school. The schools here like them to be sorted a certain way. They want them in stacks of 15 paper clip together, so they can just stick them in the teachers' boxes and they don't have to count and sort. So again, making it easier for the school, taking the flyers to the school is great. That gets the word out, and the kids can take it home. The parents can, you know, read it, and then they can call me for information. But I also put on the flyer, at the bottom of the flyer, I have the registration form and information, so they can bring that with them to the first class. And let's see. And it was just like, you know, what this kind of stuff that Lori was saying in her presentation, you know, having a plan for each class. You know, the USTA, the progression that the USTA skills follow is such a great way to manage your class, you know, starting with the basic skills, you know, dead stick the first class, and then teaching them, you know, the horizontal wrist twirl, just going from there, and then the body work and things like that. But I think the most important thing is to make it fun for the kids, so that when they get in the car at the end of the class and the mom says, "Did you have fun?" the kid's answer was going to be yes every time. You want to make sure it's always yes. And so that comes with, you know, always having a smile when you teach and bringing lots of encouragement. And I have this little club called the Forehead Sticker Club. So when they learn a skill, they get a sticker right smack in the middle of their forehead. And I make a big deal out of saying, "Welcome to the Forehead Sticker Club." So it's, you know, just all about having fun and just teaching them life skills through baton twirling is what, you know, Jackie said one time to me, that's what she does. She teaches life skills through the sport of baton twirling. And I always keep that in the back of my mind. That's what I'm trying to do. Make good little humans, you know. It's important to have upbeat music, current music, positive music, and, you know, no bad words, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I like to teach them about the safety rules and baton etiquette so that they can be coachable. You know, when I'm talking, you're not. And when I'm showing you something, watch what I'm showing you, then try it. Don't try to do it at the same time, because then you're missing what I'm trying to teach you. I like to teach fun things. You know, I schedule my classes where we review everything, all the skills up to what we've done so far. And then I teach two or three new skills or tricks or fun things. And then we work on a routine, because the only thing we have this year is our recital. So we're working on our recital right now. And I do that at the end so that they're learning something new, you know, before they go home. And I think I think that's about it. Does anybody have any questions? I know I kind of went through that really fast, but are there any questions for me anywhere, Tom, or anybody?
Stacy, you make me want to go out and start a program. You make us sound so easy and fun.
It really is easy and it really is fun.
That's great. This sounds great. This has been great information. I have a question actually for Thomas. Thomas, being a school principal, what was your impression about the connection that Stacy had to her school and principal? What was your reaction to that?
Oh, she had it all down. I was going to write in chat, as a former principal, she would have had the first space after school without any.
Thank you.
Of course, word might have preceded that. There's another baton twirler who's found space at my schools also.
I love it. They're very supportive. All the principals that I've dealt with have been very, very supportive of my program. They ask me, they actually reach out now before the new year and ask if we're going to come back. We have a program in Baldwin County where I teach is Leader in Me. And this is part of Leader in Me. I mean, we're developing leaders.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Stacy, I will add a question that's come through in the chat and share it with you. One of them is, a question came in, what kind of lesson plans do you have? And so you shared a little bit about what you did, but if you have any lesson plans or anything like that you feel like sharing, you can feel free to share with me and I will share with the group if you so choose.
Okay.
But the other thing I think is interesting is that the challenge is not with the principals now, it will be with the school districts.
Right.
As things go on, and I would hazard a guess that Alabama is a little bit looser in that regards than some of the other states. We are hearing, and I'm experiencing even here in Portland, greater difficulty getting into a school for an after-school program. And I think it's going to be a challenge that we're going to face across the country in a lot of ways, and going to have to get creative in that regard, or find ways that schools really will let us in. I think the way that you share things with the school and make things easy for the school really stand out as positives.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. We're going to keep on moving and spotlight Jody Wright, head of the Great Lakes Twirling Academy. Welcome, Jody.
Thank you. Hello.
It's really a pleasure to have you, and you agreed to do a spotlight interview. Talk to us about your twirling background and your accomplishments.
Okay, so I have the Great Lakes Twirling Academy. I've been coaching most of my life, so since I was like 15 years old, and we have a recreational program as well as we have competitive students. So kind of similar to what everyone else has talked about. I'm pretty fortunate because one of the districts that I'm in, they took one of their old elementary schools and turned it into a recreational facility. So there's like karate classes, and the youth football has kind of storage in there and they practice outside. And so we actually have an entire wing of the elementary school where we are able to, you know, we have a trophy case and we can decorate, and I have that facility at any time when I need it. Of course, it does not have high ceilings. These are just elementary classrooms. And so, but it does help to just have it and have access to it at any time. And then I work within another school district where we actually have the gymnasium a couple nights of the week. And funny thing, as you were saying about, you know, with the coronavirus and the obstacles that we have, I was one of the only programs that district continued to have throughout this school year. And so they started really promoting our program more than they ever have before. They did an article on it in the local magazine and just different things like that. So my classes were actually booming more than ever. It was one of the few programs where you could really social distance, and so they continued to help us grow with that. We did receive the Creative Challenge Award last year, the grant, and so that's really exciting.
Uh-oh. Jody, you just got muted.
Oh, can you hear me now? Okay. Yeah. So one of the things that we do is we put on a big Dr. Seuss production, and we go around to the schools or to community events, and we put on the Dr. Seuss production. Typically, it's in honor of March Reading Month, and there's been times where we did bookmarks for the kids when we went, or times when we had actual little cheap books that we were able to give to the kids at different things that we did. And it's just a highlight for my students. Like, when they're little, they're like, oh, someday I'm going to be Horton, or someday I want to be the Cat in the Hat. And they're looking forward to when they get to be, you know, a competitive twirler. And Cat in the Hat has to be able to do three baton. And there's different criteria that I look for in all of the main characters. And so that's neat. And plus, it also obviously promotes our program and then helps it to grow in that way. And then, as I said, we do have a competitive group that they can participate in at some point if they wish to. And kind of like someone else had mentioned earlier, you know, it's one of those things, like, not every kid is gonna want to be a top national champion. Not every kid is gonna have the money, the support, and all of those things that go into becoming a top champion. But every kid can learn and grow through the sport of baton twirling. Every kid can become a better person because of it, and learn those life skills and lifelong friendships. And so ultimately, that's always my top goal. I started twirling USTA when I think I was a freshman, so in high school. So I had competed my whole life, but not through USTA. And then we had started doing USTA. When I first started coaching, we would host contests and things like that. You know, I would be a contest director, and I got my judges certification, but being in Michigan, there just wasn't a lot of USTA at that time. So we switched over, we did some US or NBTA, we did some TU, that kind of thing. And then about 4 years ago, my daughter, I've been blessed with three daughters too that I get to share my passion with. So, but my one daughter, she had just gotten really good. She's a great dancer, a beautiful twirler. And so we went back to USTA. I just felt like that was the place for her. We worked with Kyle and got lessons with her and that kind of thing. So I remember just sitting at my first nationals years, it was the one in Wisconsin, that would have been our first year. And so I remember sitting there and being like, I just love being back here. I love the feeling. I love the camaraderie. The scoring system, the whole entire vibe was so different. And so I'm really grateful to be back. And I think we're really trying to grow things back up here in Michigan, the few coaches that we do have. So hopefully we can continue to do that. So I'm working on getting my judges certification renewed and such to do all of those things.
Yay. Thank you very much, Jody. I really appreciate the time you took to share a little bit about us. And I was going to mention that Creative Challenge Award if you didn't. Thanks very much for mentioning that. It was quite an outstanding application involving literature and all sorts of things. School teachers absolutely loved it. I'm going to keep us moving at this point. Is Shannon Barker in the house? Shannon, I saw you a minute ago. Are you still online?
Yes.
Hey, welcome, Shannon Barker.
Hi, welcome. Let me stop my class.
All right, go ahead. Crisscross applesauce.
Hi, everybody. We're right in the middle of class. I'll let you know what's going to be going on, though. I'm going to throw out at you a few concepts about roles for beginners, actually pre-novice. And I'm actually teaching a creative movement class right now, but they twirl as part of their curriculum. So that's, you'll see some of the things that get introduced to them. And these things can help them develop roles as they progress. And after about 5 minutes, they're going to be dismissed. And then I'll be teaching a few roles to a 9-year-old who loves roles. And then it's all over with. So anyway, I'll try to introduce as many techniques that are very helpful for success in roles as I possibly can. So here we go. Up you go. So we're going to start with doing some balances. So pick any place that you want to balance your baton. There you go. And you can change positions the whole time. while I talk to these other coaches. So normally we might start with all the same balance and then we branch out from there, but roles is just one long series of balances. And so it's great fun to introduce this at a pre-novice level so that it's not a strange concept for them. And they definitely figure out where the center is this way. And now go ahead and do it in low space. Same thing. So we combine everything with movement. We seldom just stand around while we're twirling. So as you can see, they've come up with quite a few interesting poses themselves. So let's move on to some traps. So stand up. Figure out where you might want to trap the baton. There you go. And it doesn't have to be in the center for your traps, but usually it works good that way. But trapped in our ponytail, everywhere. And of course, traps get used a lot in rolls. And so by introducing it now, it's not a foreign concept. Do it underneath your chin. Good. And then let's put the baton over on the side of your neck and then trap it. Nice. And you pick out a trap somewhere while you're in low space. We've got a little mermaid in the front. That is Kendra Breeze and Donna McAtee's grandmother, grandchild there doing the excellent. Lots of creativity. All right, up you go. Then, and I'm going to look at my notes, what I'm going to do. Normally, I never have to look at notes unless I'm on the hot seat like this. We'll do some slides. So do your slides. And when you're doing them, nice to see that you all have straight arms. Yay. A lot more fun with straight arms. And now do something with your feet. Get in first position or a tendu or a passe or an arabesque. Nice, smile, good, very good. They've got such a beautiful smile on for you. All right, and let's try it with just one arm. So hold on, not in the center, not by the end, but somewhere right in the middle there. Put it at the top, oh, you read my mind, Janelle. Put it at the top of your biceps, the top of it. Give it a push, and if you stare at it, it should roll right down into your hand. Keep it up. So when they're doing something like this, they really catch on to the whole center situation. And so that's obviously helpful. All right, baton twirlers. Okay, we only have one more minute to show them and we're gonna move on. So hold on and let's do our roll the baton back and forth. So just roll it on your neck. Good, do a tendu while you do that. Front side or back, I don't know where. And let's see, roll it on your arm, back and forth. Good, now do a passe. Good, keep rolling. And now roll it on your leg. Excellent, and now hold on, not in the center, not by the end, but somewhere in between there. Hold your arm out. Hold it as still as you possibly can, touch it. Roll it for a moment, and then you're going to roll it all the way over. And try that one again. And I just started teaching these, instead of starting underneath, I just started teaching them in front recently, because by going like this, they feel the roll, and then when they roll it over, it actually is a roll. So when they start doing rolls, they understand that. All right, folks. We are ready to hit a pose. Actually, before you do that, do your favorite roll. Any roll, one you made up and one that I showed you. Good to see you holding on close to the center. And Janelle's holding her elbow really still while she does it. That's good. Nice. Aria is trying really hard to stare at the center while she's doing it. We've got some people experimenting doing it by the end.
hit a pose. Ta-da-da-da. Hold it right there. I'll clap for you. Hold it. Hit another pose. Smiling. All right. Good. Okay, stand up. Yay. Go ahead and line up over here with Deanna. Socially distant, please. And out you go. Janelle, back up a little. All right. So they're leaving class, and Deanna, thankfully, will take good care of them out there. Out you go. And Hudson, come on over. This is Hudson. Hudson's a 9-year-old, and he loves rules. Come closer. Right about here. So Hudson hasn't been twirling all that long, actually. But what we're going to do is demonstrate elbow-arm roll, because it's a way that I teach it. There's all different ways to teach it, but the way that I teach it really helps them achieve the roll quickly. So hold on with the tip up and hand at your neck. And this time I want you to stand in second. By the way, good posture, of course, is fabulous. And as they get more secure, then I have them put their feet together or in other positions. But to learn a roll, I have them stand in second position parallel so that they have a good sturdy base, good posture. All right, fingers together. So now go ahead and do your elbow roll and catch it straight up and down. Right. And then reach out and do that some more. Just keep doing that. Whoops. Stop at the vertical. Okay. So he already knows an elbow roll, but by stopping at the vertical, then he knows the special moment that he's going to have to move his arm out. Now, oh, I'm glad you just did that. So he's doing a slight ricochet, which until they can do it with no ricochet, they don't learn how to put their arm out first. Now go ahead and stop it. Make it not ricochet. Catch it sooner. Do it again. Catch it sooner. There you go. Put it down in front of you. Roll it in your hand and back pass. Keep doing that. Stop it. Out. Right. So by doing that over and over, his body learns, his brain learns what's happening. And then in short order, go ahead and do the elbow arm roll. Just connect it. In short order, he can do that. Keep going. Yeah. And he keeps it right in front of his face. He stares at the center. And these are things that don't necessarily come natural. And he knows where to hold his baton. And so that the center is what's doing the rolling. And of course, he has good posture. His body's squared off. And he's putting his arm directly in front of him. Now, Hudson, go ahead and do your hand roll and trap it. And then trap back and forth. Come with your fingers together and then roll. Right. So by doing that a lot of times, then it helps this athlete get so that they can go right into it. Now do your hand, double hand. There you go. Start off center. Go ahead. Now do elbow arm trap. Elbow arm trap, just trap on top. Do it again. Keep going. So this elbow arm trap, if they can trap it on top and just trap it, and that trap it on the first hand. Trap on the there. Keep doing that. If they can do that, then it's easy to simply have them go ahead and roll it after that once they learned how to stop it there. Now let's see you go ahead and connect it. There you go. Great. All right. Moving on. This one is a torturous twirl for a lot of coaches. So do your hand roll. When it's vertical, pull it straight into your face, roll it over, catch underneath. Good. And do it again. Hand roll. Uh-huh. So the whole, put your fingers together now. The whole thing is that it's vertical and that he's watching the baton and it's in front of his face. His posture is good. Right. And if you have your arm too high, Hudson, what'll happen?
It'll slide down towards your face.
Yeah, it'll slide down in his face. So a lot of athletes do that. They're constantly lifting their elbows up, their arms up when they're doing their rolls. And there, good. Do an experimental elbow roll, holding on by the end, and just roll it over and let it flop. So I usually have them experiment like that, and so that they're aware of the mistake rather than simply having them do it the right way. Now choke it and see if it doesn't go there. And
so he also learns it that way. Then I have them get it, and so it's slightly off center.
All right. So now do your elbow arm, hand elbow all together. Good. There's a lot of baton coaches watching, and they'll go, oh, but his fingers aren't together. Put your fingers together on the second one. There you go, on that second hand. Now we'll practice on that. All right, so now, Hudson, let's do, combining that. So if a person goes ahead and does the double hand roll into the retraction, or that, yeah. Go ahead, do the elbow arm, hand catch. Hand catch, right. So you connect those two together, and now start at the double hand and pull into the retraction. With your fingers together. Close enough. So anyway, you start in the left hand, but that works. And then put it all together. All right. And then next off is TikTok. Go ahead and do your TikTok in front. Hold the tip up. And this is to get a feel for this pendulum feel, because this also gets used a lot in rolls, especially, let's put the, yeah, all right. And now do it front and back. Do it front and back. So the pattern's on the side. With your arm out straight in front of your shoulder. So we didn't rehearse on this, and he's doing a great job of following directions. Just do TikTok back and forth. Keep it. Put it in front of you more. Right. So keep doing that and loosen up your grip. If athletes don't understand about doing this, then it's almost impossible for them to get good hand, well, it is impossible to get good hand rolls going. So go ahead and do figure eight hand rolls. Hold, yeah, there you go. Well, when it's over here, Hudson, stop. I'm so glad he's making this issue, because here, make it go here, up and over, hand roll. There you go. Hold on over here. Off center. Oops, no, that's right. Hand roll. Now go like this. Keep the ball go back. You go up and over. Mm-hmm. There you go. And so you'd work with your athlete. Go ahead and get in fifth position. And keep doing it. You'd work with your athlete until their pattern was absolutely flawless, because that makes a big difference in their execution of fishtails, if they've got that. And then do a quick other one. Oh, the continuous rolls. So Hudson's just started playing with these. And I say the word playing because he literally plays with his rolls, don't you? Yeah, he loves rolls. All right, so we start with our feet together, and we step on the left foot on the hand. And then other than that, it's always lined up with the feet and the baton are supposed to be completely in sync with each other. So a good thing to do is to seek out help from other instructors if that doesn't make sense to you, because if the feet aren't correct, then it's very difficult for an athlete to do rolls, continuous rolls. So now let me see you just try to do your continuous rolls. Almost there, keep trying. So when you do the continuous rolls, of course you'd want your athlete to be up on their toes, but more importantly, get your baton here, is to wait until it's vertical, and after it's vertical, the other side, and then after this way comes in. Yeah, and now turn all the way to the side and face it at 1 o'clock, and then down it comes till it's vertical. Remember, and then out and hand. So the turn happens after it's vertical, and then straight up and down, out. All right, one more try. Ooh, that was very close. All right, okay, let's see you do your reverse fishtails for everyone.
Okay.
Oh, I'm glad you're doing three more. After we do our fishtails, we always, go ahead and do it again. We do three more after we drop, and go ahead and do it with the forward ones too. By doing three more, they quickly develop more fishtails because there's not a constant fight going on with the baton. There's a fight with the athlete for a while to get them to do that, but by dropping it, yeah, that works. Now, if your arm is shoulder high on the forward fishtails, that's great. If your arms are lower on your reverse, there you go. All right. Okay, Hudson, hit a pose for everyone. Da, 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 da. All right. Thank you, Hudson. Okay. So there we go. And yeah, we can do other roles, but it's obviously 6 minutes past now. So we can stop at that.
Shannon, thank you very, very much.
Welcome.
Great to see the progression and the attention to detail that really makes a difference in what goes on. Any questions, anybody? Shoot them out there if you have any. Couple in the chat, let's see. Way to go, Hudson. Fantastic job, Hudson. I think they liked you, Hudson. Thank you very much, Hudson, for doing that.
He's gonna grow up in me in Cirque du Soleil. He doesn't know that yet, but he is. Oh, he does know that, I guess.
Thanks, Shannon Barker.
All right, you're welcome. Thanks, everybody.
All right. Well, we are at the end of our meeting today. Sorry for going a little bit late. Hope it was worthwhile for you to stay late. Our next and last meeting of the year is May 11th, Tuesday, and it will feature not only Shirley Doherty, but we're also hoping to have Glenn Bittenbender and Nikki Riley and maybe Tracy Hughes as well. It promises to be a full agenda. Thanks a lot for coming, everybody. Good night.